Good evening, students. Welcome back to the second part of banking transaction chapter. In the previous class, you have already learned about the meaning of banks, its characteristics, and its functions. In this class, we shall learn about the relationship between bankers and customers, role of banks and post offices in financial transaction, and different types of banks and the different types of bank accounts that we can open in a bank. Let us begin with the first part, that is relationship between bankers and customers. The relationship between the banker and customers fall under two broad categories. One is general relationship and another is special relationship. In general relationship, the first relationship between a banker and a customer is that of a debtor and a creditor. Let us see what does the relationship of a debtor and a creditor mean. When a customer deposits money with a bank, the customer becomes a lender and the bank becomes the borrower. When the banker lends money to the customer becomes the debtor and banker becomes the creditor. This is the relationship of a debtor and a creditor between a bank and the customer. Second relationship is that of a trustee and a beneficiary. A trust is a relationship between two persons by virtue of which one of them is called trustee and holds property vested in him for the benefit of the others, called as beneficiary. For example, we'll see. If a customer deposits securities or other valuables with the banker for safe custody, he acts as a trustee of his customer. The customer continues to be the owner of the valuables deposited with the bank. The bank becomes the beneficiary. The third is that of a relationship of an agent and a principal. We have seen that nowadays banks render agency services for their customers, like they pay insurance premium, they pay electricity bills, taxes, etc. However, they collect interest on investments, dividends on shares, checks, etc. Bankers act as per the standing instruction of their customers. For these services, the bankers charge a nominal commission from the customer. The banker, by providing these services, acts as an agent, and the customer, who gives the standing instruction, acts as a principal. Hence, the relationship of a banker and a customer is that of an agent and a principal. Now, we will see the second relationship, that is called a special relationship. The first one is obligation to honor checks. Here, it is the duty of the people to have sufficient funds in their account when they give checks to others. Similarly, whenever checks come to the bank people also have an obligation to honor it. The second obligation of a bank is to maintain secrecy of accounts. They are bounden not to tell the account of an individual person to anybody else. We shall now see the services offered by banks. What all services do banks give us? First service, they give us debit and credit cards. Most of us nowadays use ATM cards. These cards are given by the bank. Second, bank gives us personal loans. Personal loan may be your home loan, it may be an educational loan, it may be a personal loan to construct our house or for furnishing our house or anything else. The third one is home and vehicle loans. Banks give us loan to purchase homes, to construct a new house, to purchase new vehicles, it may be a two-wheeler or a four-wheeler, or any kind of vehicle. Banks help us to invest in mutual funds and in stocks. Fifth one is safe deposit lockers. Most of the banks have got lockers. We people tend to keep our valuables in those lockers for which we pay a fixed rent. Bank also acts as a trust services. They stand as guarantee. And last one is e-banking services. E-banking services are your online banking, like your Nift banking, Paytm, Google Pay, or any other modern banking that you do through electronic means. Thus, these are the services offered by banks. Now we shall see about banking transactions. Any sort of activity involving in money or exchange of money in an account is viewed as bank transaction. Banks in general are institutions that deal with money. Banks keep money of the customers in the form of deposits, and the money thus collected is lent to the customers who need money as loans. These loans are called as bank loans. As I already told you, banks give loan to people in different forms. It may be a housing loan, it may be a personal loan, it may be a vehicle loan. Banks lend money and collect interest on loans. A part of interest collected on loan is given to the depositors as interest. When we take loan from the bank, we people pay certain amount of interest on that loan. Similarly, using that interest that the banks collect, they give us interest for the amount that we keep as deposits. This interest forms the income of the depositors. Banks invest the customers' money in national and international business and increase their funds. All the banking transactions in India are controlled by the main bank, that is called as the Reserve Bank of India or the RBI. The RBI is also called as the mother of banks, Bankers Bank or Central Bank of India. It formulates the monetary policy which should be followed by all the banks. In short, it is the head of all the banks. All the rules and regulations that are needed for a bank to function are formulated by the Reserve Bank of India according to the guidelines and policies drafted by the Reserve Bank of India. All the other banks in India function. We shall now see the role of the Indian Postal Department in banking transaction. The recent development in banking history is the inclusion of post offices into its fold. Earlier, post offices were meant only for sending letters, couriers, parcels, money orders, but now the government has included even the postal department into the main area of banking transaction. The Indian Postal Department is planning to start a bank to be tentatively called as the Postal Bank of India, with a network of over 1.55 lakh post offices spread all over India. 90% of them are in around semi-urban and rural areas. The post offices continue to render service in the banking area by offering the following services. Monthly recurring deposits. They are called as RDs. People keep monthly a fixed amount in the bank. It may be from as small as 500 rupees up to any amount. After 1 year, along with the interest, the amount is given back to the customer. The second one is postal insurance. People do insurance in post offices also. The third one is pensions, and the fourth one is money transfer. Money transfer may be in the form of postal money orders, money transfer that takes place. The Postal Department is promoting a capital investment of about 1,000 crores for bank transaction, and this will be very shortly set up with a subsidiary of the Postal Department. One advantage of Postal Department coming into banking sector is it will cover most of the rural areas, since post offices are situated in even the remotest rural area of our country. This post office helping in banking transaction will go a long way in making even the rural people have access to banking transaction also. Now we shall see the different types of banks that we have in India. Today we have State Bank Group, 20 nationalized banks, 21 private banks and 19 foreign banks. In your textbook it is given as 20 nationalized banks, but in 2020, after the merger of banks, we have only 12 nationalized banks in India. The important among them being State Bank of India, Central Bank of India, Allahabad Bank, Canara Bank and others. Among the private banks of India, the important ones are Axis Bank, HDFC, ICICI and a few others. Among the foreign banks that we have in India, the important ones are American Express, Citibank and HSBC. In total, there are about 8,000 branches spread across India. They include rural banks, regional banks, government and private banks also. There are different types of banks specializing in different activities. The important banks categorized like this are the Central Bank, also known as the Reserve Bank of India, which as I already told you is the mother of all the banks. It is the bank that frames the guidelines and policies for all the other banks to be followed. Then we have commercial banks like Axis Bank, HDFC, ICICI and a few others that give us loan for housing loans, personal loans, vehicle loans and others. Then we have the Industrial Development Bank of India, known as IDBI. This bank mainly gives emphasis on lending loans for industrial developmental sector in India. Then we have land development banks. Apart from that, the other important banks are indigenous banks, which are mainly situated locally or in particular regional geographical areas. They also include the money lenders or the so-called saukars who lend money to people. Then comes the most important among regional banks, that is cooperative banks. Cooperative banks are there in almost every village or in every semi-city areas. For example, in Bijapur, we have Siddheshwar Cooperative Bank. Now, we shall see about what type of bank accounts can be opened in the bank. Mainly, there are four types of bank accounts. They are saving bank account, current account, recurring deposit account, already also known as RDs, and then term or fixed deposit account known as FDs. We shall now see about savings account. Savings account is generally opened in banks by salaried persons or by people who have a fixed regular income. This facility is also given to students, senior citizens, pensioners and others. The main reason why people are encouraged to open savings account is to encourage people to save money and pool their savings. There is no restriction on the number and amount of deposits. The amount can be withdrawn either by a check or through a withdrawal slip available in the respective banks. Nowadays, because of e-banking facilities, many people tend to transfer amount using electronic mode of transfer like NEFT, RTGS, Google Pay, Paytm and others. Saving banks account, in short, is known as SP account. The next type of bank account which we will be learning today is called as current account. Current account is usually opened by businessmen who have a large number of regular transactions with bank. It includes deposits, withdrawals and contra transactions. In current account, amount can be deposited or withdrawn any number of times in a day. Generally, banks do not give any interest on these deposits but collect service charges or bank charges on such account. In a saving bank account, what we have learnt earlier, banks give certain amount of interest for the deposits that we keep. But in current account, banks do not give any interest for the current account. In fact, in current account, banks charge service charges from the customers for maintaining that account. Current account is suitable only for business people. The third type of account which you will be learning today is known as recurring deposit account, or in short, famous as RD amount. These deposit accounts are generally opened for a purpose to be saved for a future date. For future requirement, deposits are made regularly on a monthly basis. For example, for the purpose of wedding expenses of children, to buy costly items like land, car, gold, etc. After the period is over, the total amount is repaid with interest. For example, in RD account, suppose a person keeps every month 1000 rupees for 2 years. So at the end of 2 years, he will get back his 24,000 rupees along with the rate of interest prescribed at the time of opening the account. The next type of account which we will be learning is called as fixed deposit account, or in short, FDs. This type of account is opened for a fixed period by depositing a particular sum of amount for a period of, it may be a month, 6 months, 1 year, 5 years, or 10 years. The deposited amount cannot be withdrawn before the expiry of the term. For example, if you keep the amount for 1 year, you have to wait for 1 year for the amount to be withdrawn along with the rate of interest. The rate of interest is more depending upon the term in this deposit account. Banks, it depends upon the bank about the rate of interest that they give on FDs. It even differs on the period. For example, the rate of interest for a 6 months period may be different from that of a 5 year or a 10 year period.